Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. This is Karen Sharp with another session in our series of discussions on the study of racialism with Professor Randolph Hemmings. Good afternoon, Professor. I am sure that the viewers are looking forward to today's topic.
Thank you, Karen. I'm glad to be here. Today's topic is, why are Europeans white? Of course, the color white is merely a social designation. The real question is, why do Northern Europeans have such little pigmentation? Here is a map of human skin tone. The natives of Northern Europe are oddly light-skinned. They are paler than anyone else on Earth. Most people know that this has something to do with sunlight, UV, latitude, and vitamin D. Here is a map of solar UV at the surface taken from satellite. It matches the skin tone map everywhere but Europe. The closer you are to the equator, the darker your skin. This is because humans are extraordinarily sensitive to sunlight on the skin. Humans do not have fur. UV rays produce vitamin D and reduce folate when they hit naked skin. And embryos are terribly vulnerable to both substances in the mother. When it comes to sunlight and skin tone, furless humans are balanced on a knife blade. If a pregnant mother is too pale-skinned under intense sunlight, then too much UV penetrates her skin. This increases vitamin D but reduces folate. Lack of folate causes neural tube defects in the fetus, causing such congenital abnormalities as craniorachitis, anencephalus, and spina bifida, leading to many miscarriages. On the other hand, if she is too dark-skinned under dim sunlight, then too little UV penetrates her skin. This increases folate, but reduces vitamin D. Lack of vitamin D causes skeletal neonatal abnormalities. These include skull, chest, and leg malformations. Rickets being the best known. Again, this causes miscarriages. And so, humans adapt very quickly to solar UV. Prehistoric groups that migrated towards the equator got darker. Prehistoric groups that migrated away from the equator got lighter. But this explanation fails for Northern Europe. Northern Europeans are lighter than everyone to the south, Mediterraneans, to the east, Mongols and East Asians, to the west, Native Americans across the Atlantic, and to the north, Inuit, Sami, Chukchi, Aleut. Clearly, there once was a factor at work in Europe other than dim sunlight. Here is another map of skin tone. Again, the blob surrounding the Baltic Sea is like nothing else on the planet. That this pale population surrounds the Baltic gives the first hint. It must have something to do with the oceans. Baltic depigmentation is not just in the skin. Here is a map of hair color. The pigment, melanin, colors hair as well as skin. Adult blondes are native only to this unique region. Children around the world are often blonde, but their hair darkens at puberty. So it is not just Northern European adult skin that lacks pigment. It is also adult European hair. But the Baltic depigmentation is not just in the skin and hair. Here is a map of eye color. Melanin colors eyes, as well as skin and hair. Adults with blue eyes are native only to this unique region. Babies around the world are often born with blue eyes, but their eyes darken within a few months. So it is not just Northern European skin and hair that lack pigment. It is also Northern European eyes. Skin, hair, eyes, adult European pigmentation resembles that of children elsewhere. This gives the second hint, neoteny. To solve the puzzle, we must figure out when it happened. When did the inhabitants of the Baltic region lose their melanin? Well, it must have happened after 16,000 years ago. The Baltic region was covered by ice before then and nobody lived there. In fact, it probably happened after 13 millennia ago. Cave art from that time always shows normally pigmented people. Notice that in this painting from 13,000 years ago, the hunters are the same color as the deer. On the other hand, it must have happened before 4.6 thousand years ago, because depigmented people first began to appear in art at that time. These Egyptian statues were painted in 2613 BC. They portray Prince Rahotep and his consort Nefert, of the Old Kingdom, early 4th dynasty. Notice that he is brown, but she is pink. And so, the next step in solving the puzzle is to ask, what happened in Europe between 13,000 years ago and 4.6 thousand years ago? What happened was the invention and spread of agriculture. Before 10,000 years ago, people everywhere lived by hunting and gathering. Then, almost simultaneously, cereal growing was invented in four spots around the globe: Iraq, wheat, barley, rye, China, rice, Nigeria, sorghum, and Mexico, corn, or maize. What does skin tone have to do with eating grains? Even in darkness, humans get vitamin D from eating meat and fish. Otherwise they could never inhabit the Arctic. This USDA chart shows the vitamin D content of various foods. All meats have some vitamin D. Fish have very high amounts. But grains have no vitamin D at all. People who eat grains do not get vitamin D from food, they must get it from sunlight. This usually works out fine, because grains grow only where it is warm. And this means only in latitudes with bright sunlight, with one exception. People who live in low latitudes, where they can live off grains, get plenty of sunlight. People who live in dim sunlight cannot grow grains, and so they get vitamin D from the meat and fish that they eat. The exception? There is only one spot on the planet where grains will grow despite subarctic sunlight. It is where the warm waters of the Gulf Stream wash ashore. The Baltic is the only place on Earth where ocean currents keep it warm enough to grow grain despite dim sunlight. When the inhabitants of this region switched to grain, about 6,000 years ago, they suddenly got insufficient vitamin D to survive. They had stopped eating mostly meat and fish, in a place where sunlight was too dim to produce vitamin D, in normally pigmented skin. And so they adapted, by retaining into adulthood the infantile trait of extreme paleness. Blonde hair and blue eyes were other infantile traits that were just swept along accidentally. Well, Karen, that is my presentation for today. Thanks for listening. Do we have any phone-in questions?
We do, Professor. But before we answer listeners' questions, I wanted to say, that was just fascinating. Thank you so much. To be honest, I never liked the explanation that told only about the sun's ultraviolet. After all, native peoples who live on the shores of the Arctic Ocean get less sunlight than Northern Europeans, and yet they are visibly darker.
That's right, Karen. Nowadays, all of the hypotheses that explain Northern European paleness depend on something beyond sunlight alone. Perhaps one of our listeners will bring some up.
Our first question comes from Sally Prentice of St. Paul, Minnesota. She says, the cave painting was not very convincing, since the artist might have had only one pigment.
Yes. I agree. Nevertheless, other paintings of the time used multiple colors. The main point, however, is that the Baltic was covered by glaciers until then. So when the ice melted, and the region was repopulated from the Mediterranean and from Africa, either the people who moved to the Baltic got paler over the generations, or everyone else around the globe got darker. The former makes more sense than the latter.
A question from Suresh Patel, of Aberdeen. He read somewhere that the Northern European paleness might have resulted from either sexual selection or drift. Could you comment on that?
Excellent question. It brings up the other two main hypotheses. Sexual selection says that males carry a gene to prefer light-skinned females, which they inherit from light-skinned females. Or vice versa. It was supported by the great Cavalli Sforza, and is advocated today by Peter Frost. The problem with the sexual selection hypothesis is that sexual selection normally produces dimorphism, differences between the sexes. Examples of human sexual selection are that females stay cute into adulthood, but males do not, or that differences between male and female bodies are greater than needed for childbearing. But there is no sex difference in skin tone among Northern Europeans. In fact, since sub-Saharan females tend to be lighter than males, one could better argue that the very dark skin tone of the Bantu-speaking peoples resulted from sexual selection. Drift, on the other hand, is more plausible. Its flaw is that the constant ebb and flow of migrations and invasions into Europe would likely have stifled drift.
A question from Miriam da Silva of Rio de Janeiro. Are you saying that Europeans were once black?
Oh no. Not at all. I'm simply saying that they were once the same skin tone as everyone else at the same latitude. That is, about like Sicilians, Arabs, Mongols, or Native Americans.
We have time for only one last question. Antonio Sanchez of Miami, Florida asks about our species' original skin tone before we spread around the globe and adapted to local conditions. Were we white, black, or in between?
Well, no one knows for sure, because skin color does not fossilize. But my guess is in between, like the Khoisan of the Kalahari, or the Oromo of Ethiopia. I say that because those two populations are closely related despite their geographical separation. They predate the migrations of the Bantu-speaking peoples, and they are the oldest living lineages of our species.
Thank you, Professor. That's all the time we have today, folks. Please come back next week when Professor Hemmings will discuss the heredity of racial traits. This is Karen Sharp, signing off.